this is Simone and welcome to A Road Through Travels Angels and Demons Tour.
In the last episode, we visited inside the Church of Santa Maria del Popolo and found out it's even more amazing than Dan Brown made it out to be in his novel. It's rich not only in treasured art created by some of history's most amazing masters like Raphael, Bernini, and Caravaggio, but it's filled with creepy tombs, skulls, and symbols surrounding death and afterlife that are both Christian and pagan. And with creepy legends of evil spirits and ghosts, this church made a perfect setting for a novel like Angels and Demons. In this episode, we're stepping out of the church and into its piazza, Piazza del Popolo, because here we'll not only find more amazing Baroque architecture and style, but more Christian and pagan symbols, once again coexisting side by side. We'll also visit one of Dan Brown's main characters from his other novel, the Leonardo da Vinci, where the genius of this great master has come to life. And of course, we'll see where the movie Angels and Demons was taped during the Santa Maria del Popolo segment, since, as you know, they're banned from filming inside any of the churches in Rome. Let's go!
Hello, this is Simone and welcome to A Road Through Travels Angels and Demons Tour.
When you come out of the church, you'll notice a wall next to it with an arched entrance. This is Porta del Popolo, or the People's Gate, but it was once called Porta Flaminia in ancient Rome. That's how old this is. And it's also the starting point of Via Flaminia, the most important route in history going north from Rome. And for centuries, before trains, Vespas, and guided tours, if you were a tourist coming to Rome, this would have been the first view you'd get of Eternal City. Pope Alexander II asked Bernini to restore the inner facade of this ancient gate in preparation for the arrival of Queen Christina of Sweden after she converted to Roman Catholicism and abdicated her throne. The inscription on the plaque above translates to "a happy and prosperous entry." Apparently, it worked. She was so happy in Rome, she never left. Maybe they can put the same sign above the Fiumicino airport door as you walk out and get the first glimpse of Rome when you arrive. Wouldn't that be something? On the other side of the gate is the Flaminio metro stop, the only efficient means of public transportation to bring you to this piazza. Named Piazza del Popolo, or the People's Square, it was then, like it is now, a gathering place for the people of Rome. But unlike just concerts, celebrations, and political campaigns that take place now, back then, they also held gruesome public executions that lasted until about 1826. Probably that's when they realized execution displays did nothing to improve Rome's image for tourism. The piazza itself didn't always look like this. In the 1500s, a former fountain was replaced with Obelisk Flaminio, an ancient Egyptian obelisk from Heliopolis that belonged to none other than Ramses II. It was brought to Rome by Emperor Augustus in 10 BC, who erected it on the spina, or the spine, of the famous Circus Maximus that's right near the Forum and Palatine Hill. This is the second oldest and one of the tallest obelisks in Rome. It seemed fashionable back then to add a point of interest in important piazzas with an obelisk dug up from ancient Roman temples or circuses. You see many of these obelisks throughout Rome's major piazzas. Later on, in 1800s, fountains with Egyptian-style lions were added by Pope Leo XII. Who else? On each side of the piazza, you'll notice a beautiful fountain, but the one on the east side that gets most attention is set at the foot of Pincio Hill and its gardens, which appear as though they will cascade onto the piazza at any given moment. Both fountains depict classical pagan figures, with the west fountain depicting Neptune, and this one, Roma. If you walk up a flight of steps on either side of this fountain, you will not only get a glorious view of the piazza, but you can also walk to Pincio Gardens, as well as to the famous Villa Borghese Gardens. This Baroque-inspired symmetry is carried to the opposite end of the piazza, to the twin churches, Santa Maria dei Miracoli, St. Mary of the Miracles, and Santa Maria de Montesanto, St. Mary of Montesanto. The architect of the piazza, Giuseppe Valadier, went to great lengths to create an illusion of identical symmetry between the churches when viewed from the distance. But when viewed up close, they're architecturally unique from one another. Surrounding these two churches is a trident of streets radiating from the center. To the far left, Via del Babuino takes you to the Spanish Steps. In the center, Via del Corso leads to Piazza Venezia. And to the right is Via Ripetta. I don't know where that goes, really. Another trio worth mentioning is the three churches dedicated to the Virgin, all in one piazza, and all of them interestingly surrounded around an Egyptian obelisk that was once upon a time dedicated to the ancient pagan sun god. With so many pagan and Christian symbols in this piazza and church, no wonder it makes a perfect setting for a novel based on religious symbols. In Angels and Demons, Bernini is a key artist embroiled in religious mystery, cults, and symbolic art. In the other Dan Brown novel turned into movie, it was Da Vinci. And I'd like to show you an amazing place right here in Piazza del Popolo that showcases the genius of Da Vinci by actually bringing his creations to life.
You can find many of Leonardo da Vinci's paintings in museums in Rome, Florence, Paris, but how about the mechanical inventions? Leonardo left behind many sketches, notes, and diagrams that aren't easy to decipher, but a group of dedicated artisans studied the intricate drawings and writings and painstakingly transformed his inventions into large wooden models down to the last minute detail, so we can admire the genius of Leonardo da Vinci and his vision that was way ahead of his time.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Vecchia Modesto, and I'm glad to be the president of Anthropos Foundation, which works on a cultural and scientific exhibit. We got the idea, we realize, we produce, and sometimes we handle and we manage museums, scientific museum, and traveling exhibits. This is one of them. This is a permanent museum of Leonardo da Vinci's invention. In Rome, we are in the Sale del Bramante, which is a wonderful historic place. And we tried with this exhibition to focus Leonardo as an inventor and scientist, more than a famous artist, painter, and sculptor as well. We tried to reproduce from the drawings of Leonardo da Vinci's all his inventions, the principles of physics and mechanics in this room, flying machines, which they will worth a lot for us in the future. The bike, for example, has been found, the drawing, in 1966. But the drawing, the project of the bike is for the end of the 15th century, and it took 400 years, more than 400 years, for the Wright brother to project a bicycle with the same size, with the same measures that Leonardo gave to his project. And then of course we have the ball bearings, which they get into any wheels of any car in the world, the self-moving car, which is the prototype of the modern car, the flying machines and more war machines. Even if Leonardo was against the war, he produced a lot of drawings projecting terrible weapons and guns and cannons.
And people can touch these and yeah. How they work.
Yes. That's another point which gave us the strength to go on in this field, because we create many of the models as an interactive instrument. People that can see and handle and see how it works. And it is a great pleasure for them, for the kids, for the students, but also for the adults. You see them.
Yeah, I can hear the noise. Have these been created by anybody else before you in history?
Not before, but then after, many other groups created models. Before then, as the IBM tried to produce some models, which they have been put in Vinci, a little museum in Vinci, which is the town where Leonardo comes from, is 20 kilometers from Florence. Quite nice, but a bit too mechanic, too white, also the wood. We tried to reproduce them in a museal way, but interactive, and then we have more sophisticated plasma. They display something about Leonardo, always mostly as an engineer and inventor.
And this is a permanent museum.
Yes.
You have some other collections that are mobile, right?
Yeah, we have 5 exhibitions which are touring. One is now at the OMSI in Portland, having a great success. OMSI is the Oregon Museum of Science and Industry. It will be after Edmonton in Florida. And then we have Budapest open. In August we will open London. And then after 6 months, Manchester Museum of Science and Industry. And in 1 month time, we will inaugurate Singapore. And then we have São Paulo in Brazil. Buenos Aires is Santiago. And in September, I'm very glad, we will have a permanent museum in Cuba. The government was so glad to give us the claustrum of San Francisco de Assis, where is a beautiful building, one of the oldest building in the Americas. It's 1539, so very, very old. For America, it's a very old building. And it's a beautiful building. And Cuba is opening itself to the Western world also in this little way. The story of this building that we are so glad to be in is a very old story. It was the tombstone of the Emperor Nero's family, the Domitian family, La Famiglia dei Domizi. And the legend said that one of the lost tombstone is the real Nerone, Imperatore Nerone tomb. We don't know for sure, but we know for sure that it's very old and that has been frequented by Leonardo for sure, because Leonardo was a very good friend of Bramante, the famous architect which gives the name to this building, because he used it as his own laboratory. In between Leonardo and Bramante, this was the legend said that a walnut tree grew up on top of the first tunnel, and this walnut tree was infested by devils in the guise of crows, and so Pope Pasquale II decided to create, to organize the biggest exorcism in the history of the Christian religion, calling bishops from all the Christian world. That was 1099. Was the conquest, the first conquest and the only conquest of Jerusalem with the first crusade. And then after, they started building a little church in the left side of the building, which was the chapel where now are kept the two famous Caravaggios. And then after, with the money of the people, the offers, the Virgin Mary Chapel became Santa Maria del Popolo. That's why the Popolo. That's the story of the place.
Then
I'll tell you
story.
something else. In 15, when Leonardo was in Rome with Bramante, these are called Sala di Bramante because he had his laboratory here. After they has been at the laboratory of Bramante, has been the site of the Holy Roman Inquisition.
Mm-hmm. And Bramante also was the architect of St. Peter's, right?
Yes. And he had his laboratory inside here. They cut the marble here, everything. Mm-hmm. That's why he was a good friend of Leonardo. And they spent those 3 years together in Rome. And then after he became the Holy Inquisition site, his room.
Wow.
Incredible.
And then further in the future, it's a museum.
Of Leonardo
da Vinci.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
And for educating us on this amazing collection.
Thank you.
Beautiful history. Thank you.
Thank you to you so much.
Now, as you may know, the Vatican banned the movie Angels and Demons from being filmed in any of Rome's churches. So when it came to filming the segment that took place at Santa Maria del Popolo, they only had to go as far as across the way. The scaffold buildings in the movie that represented the church was none other than the Carabinieri station. If you notice, it was built in the likeness of the church and the palazzo behind it to add symmetry to the piazza, which was very important in the Baroque era, including a little dome. To visit the second altar of science, air, represented by the West Ponente plaque inside St. Peter's Square. If you think St. Peter's Square is void of symbols, both Christian and pagan, think again. The Vatican is an incredible place of historic, artistic, and religious significance, and one of the holiest places in the world, and the most controversial in the Angels and Demons novel. Thank you for watching. Until next time, ciao for now.